The man in charge of Transport for London, Andy Byford, he has the role of Commissioner. I need to tell you, of course, before that, he's very versed in these matters. He was President of the New York Transit Authority and Chief Executive of the Toronto Transit Commission prior to that. So he's a man who's been around the world and knows about transport. Let's bring it right back to London. Thank you for coming
in. Good morning,
Nick. And we are suitably socially distanced or whatever one has to do. Mayor Sadiq Khan says not wearing a face mask on the tube should be a criminal offence. Andy Byford, is he right?
Well, I certainly think it would make it easier. Look, at the end of the day, we try to be customer-led. And what our customers said when the rules changed on Freedom Day, our customers said in order to keep riding on the tube, they want to have confidence that it's a safe, controlled environment. So we heard loud and clear that most people want to see face masks kept. For now, we're using the conditions of carriage, but it has one big flaw. It's not backed by fines and the police can't intervene. So the mayor's right to look at options. Right now, we've got a conformance rate, sorry, of around 85-90%.
Seriously, Mr.
About that.
If
well, it depends. It depends. I rode the tube this morning. Surprise, surprise. I came in on the Piccadilly line. I'll be honest with you, it was less than that. But the average is around 90%. But
what was it on your tube?
I'm going to say it was probably around 75%. Now, of course, you don't know if people have exemptions and they may or may not be wearing a badge. But we do have 400 officers out there. Not that many people, but we do have 400 officers who are encouraging people to wear masks. Look, at the end of the day, we're going to keep it under review. Won't be in there forever. But that's what our customers said. They said they want the confidence of knowing that they're kept safe. So we're asking customers, please, conditions of carriage, maybe with a fine to come. Don't know. We'll wait and see. Please do that. It's the right thing to do.
How long do you think we'll be asked to wear masks on public transport?
Hard to say, Nick. I mean, we're certainly going to keep it under review. You know, we're keeping a very close eye on what government policy looks like. We're looking at what the rates are. We're listening to Public Health England to see what their advice is. You know, I hope it won't be forever. You know, some people like wearing masks, other people don't like wearing masks. At the end of the day, this is about encouraging people back to use public transport. With a lot of success, we're starting to see now the average ridership for TfL almost around 50%, buses around 60%, tube around 40%. On the weekends, we've had the tube ridership up to 60%. So this is good. We want people back riding public transport, not a car-led recovery. So to do that, you've got to keep it safe, you've got to keep it clean, and you've got to keep it orderly.
If I seek to get on the 21A bus or whatever it might be without a mask, does the driver have to let me on?
The driver should ask you to put a mask on. I mean, obviously, they've also got to focus on the road. They should ask you to do that. They can't enforce that. They don't want to hold up the route. They don't want to hold up everyone on the bus in order, you know, to have some sort of standoff. But, you know, our view is we can't be everywhere and police everything. We're asking Londoners, do the right thing. I myself had COVID recently. You know, I don't particularly like wearing a mask, but I do because A, I don't want to infect other people, and B, I don't want to get infected.
All right. Wouldn't it make it easier just to make it a criminal offence?
Well, it would certainly be easier. Here's my answer, Nick. It would certainly be easier if it was the same across the whole country. Right now, we're enforcing it via our conditions of carriage. On the mainline railways, they're asking people. There's no compulsion. It's purely voluntary. So in Scotland and Wales, however, you have to wear a mask. So it would certainly be easier if the same system applied across the country. What we have said for London, because we want people to ride transit, we have said, please continue to wear a mask for now.
Shall we talk about the congestion charge? Mm-hmm. It was initially raised from £11.50 to £15 a day. It was said to be a temporary measure. Now it's going to be forever. Why?
Well, because the reason for having a congestion charge in the first place has not gone away. We need to tackle ever-growing rates of congestion in the capital city. Something like £9.5 billion cost to the economy annually. And Londoners spend on average 71 hours a year in traffic jams.
With the associated
adverse impact on air quality, all those cars sitting there. So that's the reason why we do it. It's not to raise money. I'd love it if it didn't raise any money. But the money that is raised gets funded, gets put back into...
How much does it raise?
It's around £150 million a year. So that gets funded back.
Why was it necessary to take it to 10 o'clock at night?
That was in a condition of the government's funding deal with TfL. But the, what the mayor had said was he wanted to see that pared back on the weekdays to 6 p.m. to aid London's recovery. So that's the change we're consulting on.
Why don't you just do it?
Well, I think consultation is the right thing.
Who are you consulting with?
There's an open consultation. So we're saying to Londoners, do you agree with this?
Well,
we're
have
saying,
you found anyone who
and
doesn't?
And businesses. Well, businesses love it, Nick. Businesses love the fact that where the congestion charge previously went to 10 p.m. on a weekday, now it will only be till 6 p.m. Now, that materially aids theatres, other cultural attractions in and around places like where we are today.
Nobody wants to keep it until 10 o'clock. So why don't you go back this afternoon and just say we're going to do it?
Because I think there's statutory provisions that we have to follow, and I think it's only right that we do consult. And don't forget also, there are other changes. That's not the only change. We're bringing back the 90% residents discount, but we're also having a weekend congestion fare proposed, or a congestion charge proposed, which will be from 12 till 6 p.m. So again, that's aimed at tackling congestion. It's not about raising money, it's about tackling congestion.
Some Londoners have been revolting over what are called LTNs, low traffic neighbourhoods. What sort of conversations have you had with the emergency services?
Regular consultations, and you know, because we do hear these anecdotes where people are saying, I've seen an ambulance stuck in traffic, I've seen a fire engine stuck in traffic. On every single occasion, Nick, we go back and we talk to the emergency services and we say, are there any specific roads that you're particularly concerned about? Because obviously we don't want emergency services vehicles stuck in LTNs. So they do have keys to get through
Mr. Byford, someone's fighting for their breath, and an ambulance driver, he or she has to get a key out to get through an LTN. Are you really saying that's the way forward?
Well, at the end of the day, well, that's why we talk to the emergency services to say, if there's a route that is causing you problems, we'll take another look at it. But before we put one in, we do consult with emergency services, we do consult with local boroughs, we do a design, and we identify what the impact, any adverse impacts, and try to design those
out. But they can't use a key to get around a giant flower pot.
No, they can't. In that case, they couldn't, but then they would know that road has a giant flower pot, to use your example. And not to use that road. So look, at the end of the day, the LTNs are there.
You're channeling all this traffic just on a fewer roads
In some spaces we are, but here's a statistic that you might be interested in. Since the last 9 years, there's been something like a 72% increase in the amount of traffic on local roads. That is local roads where residents complain to us that they've got gridlock in their streets.
That's
they've got terrible
all the other roads.
No, this is over the last 9 years, and on that point, let's take Waltham Forest as an example. Waltham Forest, as an example, people say to us, it just causes traffic elsewhere. Actually, the London Borough of Waltham Forest has seen a 90% reduction overall traffic.
So traffic dispersal is
not as obvious an outcome as you might think it is. On average, it's traffic has been reduced by around 54%. Look, at the end of the day, across the whole
of
London.
At
the end of the day, these schemes are not permanent. If there's one that's causing real problems, we can go back and have another look at it in consultation with the borough. But let's remember why they're there. It is because there's been this exponential rise in traffic in local neighbourhoods where schools are located.
Because you've put them all on the same road, air quality. All the other side roads are closed down.
We're never going to be able to please everyone. Look, at the end of the day, actually, you'd be surprised.
I'd be staggered if you found anybody in Dulwich who
people say to me, thank you for doing that. The road that outside my house was an absolute gridlock nightmare. It now isn't. So, look, at the end of the day, we've got to get the right balance.
Why are some bus lanes going 24 hours a day?
Because they're busy bus routes.
No, they're not.
Because they are streets where we believe that we should have a regular bus route.
Why would you need... Everybody gets the reasoning between 7 through 10 and 4 through... AM 4 through 7. Everybody gets that. Why 24 hours going from Clapham to Wandsworth Town Hall or going down Deptford High Road? Why?
Well, we want the buses to move quickly.
There's no one in the damn lane.
Well, if there's no one in the...
You could fire a cannon down the lane.
If there's no one in the lane then, Nick, then it's not a problem for the other lane where regular cars go.
You're queuing going all the buses, way back. Have you ever tried to get to Lewisham Railway
Station at 5 o'clock
in the
afternoon? I'm not going to make any apology for prioritising public transport. That's my job.
But they're all belching out fumes.
No, they're not. Not if they keep going.
Cars?
Not if they keep going.
They don't keep going, Mr. Byford.
Well, I don't recall seeing too many traffic jams with respect at 3 a.m.
No, no, I'm talking about 5 p.m.
Well...
I'm so sorry, before four, at 3 p.m. before the 4 p.m. So when that could be moved. I think everyone accepts 4 through 7. Mm-hmm. Everybody gets. Mm-hmm. Why at 3 o'clock or at 7:30 p.m. do we have to have traffic jams halfway all the way back to Dulwich or Lewisham or Wandsworth or possibly your beloved Waltham Forest? Why?
Because we want to prioritise public transport. If you have buses that are flowing through, relentlessly flowing through, you may encourage some of those people who see the bus sail past, might then think, you know what, I'm going to give the bus a go. And that
is
better for London and it's better for the environment. If we can get people onto public transport, it's the way to go.
They're in their cars because they have to be. They've got kids.
Not necessarily.
Oh, you think someone drives in London for fun?
Some people prefer cars, and I have no problem with that. That's great. But what we aim to do is get the balance right on the roads. And I certainly make no apology for prioritising buses to get them through with the 70, maybe 80 people they carry, get them there quickly and safely.
Yours is an all-encompassing brief. Let's go to the railways, or let's go to Crossrail. Are we going to have opening by May 2023?
I've said publicly the Crossrail will open in the first half of 2022, so I can do better than that.
2022, I'm so sorry.
2022. Right. I said the day I got it, there will be no further slippage on the schedule or the cost that I inherited from Crossrail, and I stand by that commitment.
So the Crossrail will be, this time, where are we? This time next year?
There's two parts to it, remember. So the key bit is the bit through the middle.
Section.
That's what people want to see. So if you think about
when
it's basically...
When can I take you for a ride on that with my Oyster card?
First half of 2022... Paddington through to Abbey Wood and Canary Wharf. That's the new bit in the middle. Crossrail Board, the outgoing Crossrail Board said, sorry folks, it's going to slip to the first half of 2022. On taking responsibility for this, and I asked for that responsibility, I said there will be no slippage to that, and I reiterate that commitment on the air today. First half of 2022, it'll be the pride of London and the envy of the UK.
What are your colleagues doing as regard modelling for the new hybrid working week and how it will affect London? Do you think it will be 3 days in an office, 2 days at home or whatever? What do you think? How will it play out?
Hard to say with certainty, but we've modelled 5 scenarios and we think a hybrid scenario is the most likely, whereby big businesses, they're not going to have to see maybe 100% reoccupation of offices, certainly not anytime soon. So we're talking to industry, we're talking to commerce, we're talking to the CBI and other major employers. And I think we will see a change in travel patterns, and that will obviously have an impact on the service we provide and also the income that we generate.
Will it be necessary to put a toll on the Hammersmith Bridge?
That may be necessary. The job one, though, is to get the thing fixed. And
yes.
I'm very pleased to see that we've now reopened it, with the boroughs, rather, have reopened it for pedestrians and cyclists.
The suggestion is there could be a £3
toll
charge.
Is a possibility in order to fund the ongoing maintenance of what is, after all, a very old structure. But that's yet to be determined. Job one is to get it reopened. I think we should have a look at it, Nick. I think we need to look at the maths of it.
You know well, and when I lived in as well, New York, there's a lot of bridges that are, I think most of the bridges actually.
Yeah, not on the East River,
but some are,
and they do generate a lot of money. I understand your point.
So was that something you'd look at bringing into London?
I think we should always look at revenue options. At the end of the day, you can't put everything onto the fare payer. I mean, at the end of the day, travellers on TfL fund TfL to the tune of 72%. That's unheard of. The norm is around 40 to 50%. So we need to find new revenue sources, but all of that needs to be looked at properly. We need to do the economics and we need to work out the math.
Last couple of minutes. How alive are you to the concerns of blind people and blind campaigners about the e-scooter rollout? There have been instances,
I'm aware,
sadly, in fact, I think one gentleman, poor chap, has tumbled on a number of occasions, if not about 10 occasions. What can be done? How comfortable are you about the e-scooter trials? And what are you doing to make it better for blind folk not to fall over them?
Well, let's be clear. There certainly shouldn't be any illegal e-scooters on the road. And I'm very pleased to see that the police are taking action to confiscate e-scooters riding on the pavement and or on the road if they're not the official ones. So we're conducting a trial, as you know.
Yes.
We've got three trialists under operation. These are fundamentally different scooters. They've got bigger wheels that you have to do an e-test before you take one to make sure that you understand the rules and you can operate it safely. They've got speed limiters on them.
You say that online, do you?
Yes, you do. They're limited to 12.5 miles an hour when they could go to 50.
People leave them, and I know they. But see, people leave them.
The official ones they can't. If they did, then we would ban them from using scooters in the future. These things are GPS tracked, so that there's certain areas where you cannot enter geofenced areas, because not all London boroughs accept them at the moment. There are also speed zones, the scooter will actually automatically safely slow down. So we're very alive to this. In the same way, Nick, that we've put noise generators on our e-buses, because again, you can't really hear them. It's one of the joys of them. They're clean, they're quiet. But actually, you need to generate a buzz so that people hear them coming. The scooters, that may well be an option, to put some sort of sound on them so that blind people could hear them.
Are they going to be a permanent part of the London transport?
We shall see. It's a trial. So there's no point in having a trial if the outcome is predetermined.
When is the trial over?
It's a one-year trial, so I'd have to look up this precise date. So we're probably about 3 months into it now.
How do you judge its success? The amount of usage...
We'd look at the safety record of them. We'd look at the customer feedback. Did they like them? Did they find them easy to use? Was there any abuse of them? There's a number of factors that we'd look at. Mm-hmm. So at the end of the day, we will evaluate what the usage has been, and then we'll make a decision.
All right, last couple of things. In the Times today, one of London's most polluted streets will be pedestrianised this month. I talk of the Strand, which has been in use since the Middle Ages, links the City of London to the West End, closed to traffic over a 230-metre stretch of road at Aldwych at a cost of more than £18 million. How will the traffic get round the Aldwych then? What happens there?
Well, that's a proposal at the moment.
Ah.
I need to see the details of that before I can properly comment, Nick. But
so it's not going ahead?
Well, no. My understanding is it is. I need to look at the specific detail of it.
Well, you're the boss. Is it being part pedestrianised or
not? No. This is a Westminster street. Don't forget, that TfL doesn't run all of the streets. We previously talked about Regent Street, which is not a TfL street. Actually, you know what? I had a look at it this morning because I thought you might ask me about it. So I went and had a look at it this morning. Traffic flowing very nicely, albeit it was 7:30 in the morning. But we're not absolving ourselves from that responsibility, even though we only run a third of London streets. We talk to the boroughs about what the impact might be. I need to get into the detail of that particular
proposal.
But your
buses go through there. You must know what you're going to do.
They do. So absolutely.
It doesn't say, the Times doesn't say. Here we go. August the 19th. What's your bus driver going to do when he pulls
clearly,
up
the
or she?
No. The buses will still go through.
Oh, the buses will go through.
Buses will still go through, is my understanding. I mean, I don't know the full detail of that one. I'd have to check my facts on it, but at the end, ultimately, we always make sure that buses still have a means of getting through. It would be somewhat counterproductive if TfL conceded not having its buses go through major arteries such as the Strand.
Right. Lastly, I referenced your glowing credentials in the field of transport. One of your previous berths was in New York, and you'll be aware that the long-serving New York Governor Andrew Cuomo quit yesterday concerning allegations of a sex scandal. What was he like to work with?
Challenging. He was challenging. I mean, at the end of the day,
I can take you to an earlier quote. Towards the end of my tenure, Mr. Byford said the job had become somewhat intolerable.
Yep.
Why intolerable, Mr. Byford?
Largely because I was not left to do what needed to be done. And that's one of the things I love about London. The mayor is a demanding boss, but he gives me leeway to do what needs to be done. He's not micromanaging me. He's not second-guessing me. He's not telling me, for example, what type of signalling technology to apply to upgrade the tube. That was the opposite in New York. I was finding that even the day-to-day running of the service, there was incessant interference. And at the end of the day, it became intolerable.
Why would he not hire a bloke who knows his stuff, or a woman,
Nick, best posed to Governor Cuomo.
Lastly, celebrating last night's football results?
I
Mr.
am.
Byford, just remind the listeners.
Plymouth Argyle won 4-0 away at Peterborough in the Carabao Cup, so come on, you Greens. I'll be there on Saturday against Gillingham at Home Park.
And, of course, you'll be travelling by bus.
On the train.
Keep an eye on those approach roads to Blackheath.
I will.
And I look forward to welcoming you back here. Commissioner of Transport for London, Andy Byford, appearing here on LBC.